exactly what I'm doing in the company of the great and the good, but nevertheless, that has never stopped me before, some people would say. In doing my initial research on what the novena was about, I saw online that it was a novena of hope, and I love that theme of hope. And in doing further research, I see it's about the importance of faith in one's life, and I love that theme as well also. And I'm so delighted to be with you tonight, showing my own tuppence halfpenny worth to this sacred time reflecting on faith and hope. It's my first time in Craig Cullen, and I'm terribly impressed by the beauty of the town and the town of Carlow. And the first to greet me was the parish dog at Budding. I was very impressed to see you, because I'm a dog person myself as well. Similar to Buddy, I had a dog called Carl, and my current dog is called Bora, who is a variation of Cara. We call it Bora because of the island that my grandmother was native of, which was Inishmar, a tiny island off the coast of Lettermore in County Galway. It's now uninhabited, but many years ago there was a little community there, a little small, remote Irish-speaking island. So that's Bora. Something similar to Buddy that you have here indeed. And I'm very impressed by the two little towns adjacent to each other in conversation with poor Clare's. It's interesting teasing out the distinctness of Craig Cullen and Carlow. Very similar as well to Clare Castle and Ennis, which is right adjacent to the town of Ennis, but very distinct and very much having their own identity. So we'll reflect a little bit tonight on the two, I suppose, virtues of faith and of hope. And as you know, faith and hope are part of the theological virtues. So just to reflect a little bit, virtues, faith, hope and love are what we call the theological virtues. And we also have the cardinal virtues of prudence, temperance, justice and fortitude. And we reflect tonight a little bit on faith and hope. And we reflected yesterday, in the beautiful gospel of yesterday, on the virtue of love. So today we focus on those two virtues of faith and hope. Just to explain a little bit what a virtue is, they always think a very good way of explaining it is, say, if you're into dancing or if you're into singing, you have your own little routine of maybe doing little exercises to warm you up. And if you're into sport, and I know you are, because having lived in Galway for 40 years, I know there was great anticipation in Galway of coming to play the Carlow team last Sunday week in the start of their championship campaign. And as you look at the Carlow team and the Galway team lining up, they'd have little small exercises or routines that they would do, little skills that would perfect their talent. And a virtue is exactly that. The virtues, theological virtues of faith, hope and love, are little exercises that we have that we put into action to help us to experience, I suppose, in a deeper way, the presence of God. So just to reflect a little bit on the whole virtue of hope for a while, and then move on to the virtue of faith and the importance of living out faith and the crutch that it can be. And some of the previous speakers would have reflected deeply on that, because it is the overall theme of your novena. What a lovely idea and concept hope is. I remember as a small child when our family lived in Tullamore, where I was born, Tullamore, County Offaly. I remember going away to Gaeltacht for a 3-month Gaeltacht course when I was a tiny little boy. I was only in fourth class at the time. It was before the time of mobile phones and texting and emails and social media and Skyping and regular contacting. And every week on a Tuesday morning, for the 3 months that I was in Inverland, Connemara, the Connemara Gaeltacht, I would get a letter from my mother without fail, first thing on a Tuesday morning. And it always started with the simple words, "I hope you are well." And what a lovely greeting that is at the beginning of any communication. Dwelling on the promise of hopefulness and wellness, "I hope you are well." Nearly any letter I write now, I always like to start it that way, or an email, or whatever it is, "I hope you are well." In many of the ceremonies of confirmation that I've been delighted celebrating over the past 3 years, and we're in the height of confirmation ceremony these days, in Killaloe on Friday, Killaloe Town, we have a 50th confirmation ceremony and 16 to go. And they're very privileged times of meeting people at their best and celebrating the gifts and the fruits of the Holy Spirit. But I love taking note of the various different names that and why they choose those names. And some of the students occasionally would do an exercise of doing a little essay on why they chose their particular name. And some might have old Irish saints' names. Two of the children last week had the beautiful name Sophia, the Greek word for wisdom. And one little girl last week had the name Destiny. Another little boy in Terry class last Sunday week, he chose the interesting and strange name Fulgentius. He being a French bishop that caught his attention, and he was, to use his language, kind of cool. One of our young priests from Kerala, from India, he's based in the presbytery in Ennis, and he has the lovely name Joy. In the faith community in the cathedral in Ennis, there are a huge number of nationalities who attend Mass regularly, and there is one particular dedicated and faith-filled family from Africa, I'm not sure which of the African countries, and their three children serve Mass very regularly, and interestingly their names are Faith, Hope and Charity. Faith and Hope were actually serving Mass with another brother called Emmanuel yesterday, the 9:30 Mass. Recently we were gathering to plan some youth ministry in Barr in County Offaly, and the PP there, a man who I regard as a spiritual guru, he's a man called Father Tom Hogan, and he was reflecting on the fact that one of the students in Barr Parish this year chose Hope as a confirmation name. And Father Tom was asking the student why, and she simply said that she loved the idea that was behind Hope. At a confirmation meal just over 2 weeks ago, one of the class teachers, big, strong, wiry, athletic Tipperary farmer, he sat down beside me at the table in a place called Cock Jordan, and his first words as he picked up the dessert spoon at the table, he said to me, "This is a sure sign of Hope." He obviously loved his food, and particularly his desserts and sweet things, and at the time it was the season of Lent, and I was off dessert for Lent, and I was longing as well for the Hope that spoon would bring out, and of course waiting for the aftermath of Easter. So as the phrase goes, hope springs eternal. The past 2 weeks in the early summer sunshine, and so taken and admiring so much, and I was very conscious of it today in travelling from Galway up to Dublin to a meeting and down to Carlow afterwards, to see the beauty of nature all around and to see the glorious whitethorn and blackthorn bushes in so many locations along the roadway, and to see the colourful flowering plants and to see them so beautifully adorning the lovely town of Great Cullen and Carlow indeed as well. And my mind, of course, automatically goes back to the time of the planting of those seeds and bushes and bulbs last autumn and early springtime, when they're put into the cold dark earth of the cold autumn and early spring days. And in doing that, it's a gesture of hope and faith that they will emerge in the splendid colour of these warm, bright, early summer days. And what a great lift that sense of realised hope gives us. There is an ancient tale from the Philippines, and it's a tale of light and hope, and it runs as follows. The story was of a king who wanted to pass on his kingdom to his two sons, and he decided that whichever son would adorn two great rooms in the palace best would inherit the kingdom. And one went about diligently working and filling the room with grain and produce of the harvest and all kinds of beautiful decorations, and the other had nothing done. The more diligent of the two sons, he wanted to claim the prize, but the father said, "Be careful to wait." The second son eventually got to do a little bit of work, and he lit a tiny small candle and put it in the centre of the room. And even though the light was small, it lit up the whole room with delightful light. And the king then decided to hand over the kingdom to him, because he felt that's what people needed at that particular time, was light and hope. There's a very wise person that I visit every now and then, and I love to try and absorb some of his wisdom, because he has spent his whole life steeped in the Holy Scriptures. And in reflecting often on the art of preaching, he often tells me that the main ingredient